Today, we're going to play Monopoly on this episode of Title Tuesdays. Hey everybody, welcome back to another episode of Title Tuesdays. My name's Kevin Thatcher, the founder and CEO here at Independence Title, also known as your Title King. Don't forget to buy the book, Rescue Your Business. We're gonna continue next week on our 15-week chapter review, going chapter by chapter through the book. We offer it right on our website, titlerate.com. You can buy it super, super cheap for $9.97, shipped to your door. It's cheaper than Amazon. Go ahead, click the link below, buy the book, and we're going to continue talking about it next week. But this week, I have a very special episode. We've developed a board game. We're trying to simulate the Monopoly game to go through the home buyer edition. So as you see here on the background, we're going to go through box by box, talking about Independence Titleopoly. This is the home buyer's edition. And what I want to do is just kind of walk you through the steps of buying a home here in South Florida. As you know, one of the things we like to do at Independence Title is just add extreme value and educate you, whether you're the consumer, you're the realtor, you're the investor, you're the seller. We want to make sure you are as educated as possible so you can make an informed decision and get to the closing table together. That's the whole goal. We want to make sure we go in the deal together and we leave the deal together, just like when I was a firefighter. So the first box you see here popping up we're gonna talk about is going to be the purchase and sale contract. Tip number one is always make sure every single page is signed, initialed, and dated. There is signature on the last page, there are initials on every page, and you wanna make sure every single item is going to be initialed, signed, and dated in order to make it valid. And as most of you know, the effective date of the contract is the last date all parties signed the contract. So it's very important to make sure initials are there, and it's very important to make sure you cover every single aspect of the initials and the signatures in order to make sure you have a valid contract just in case something goes wrong and you need to enforce the terms of the contract. Got it? Great. Number two thing that we see a lot of people do, they ask us all the time, do I need to put up a deposit? The answer is yes. You need to put money up on a deal in order for it to be valid. I don't care if you put up $10. I don't care if you give the seller a $10 bill and you take a picture of it and you have them sign a receipt. In the state of Florida, in order for a contract to be valid, the attorneys say you must have, that's right, a deposit. So your first deposit is what? It's typically done 1 to 3 days from the time the contract is executed. Some people put it in the day they do the contract, some people put it in before, some people do it within 3 days after the effective date of the contract. I don't care when you do it, but you need to put up a deposit within the terms of your contract. This third box we're talking about is your second deposit. The contract calls for a first deposit and a second deposit. If your second deposit says blank, guess what? You don't have to put a second deposit up. But if you're a real estate agent or you drafted the contract yourself and it says you're gonna put up a $1,000 first deposit within 3 days and it says you're gonna put up another $5,000 deposit within 10 days, guess what? You better make sure you put that deposit up. It is super important to make sure all deposits are put in escrow. You need to make sure you put that deposit up, whether it's with your real estate agent, whether it is with your title company or real estate attorney, or with the seller. Just make sure you get a receipt for putting that money up. Now, the second deposit, a lot of people ask, it's typically 10 days. That's what the standard contract says. But again, you need to follow the terms of the contract. The fourth box we're talking about is loan application. Your contract calls, if you are going to be getting financing, it calls for you to apply for your loan within a certain period of time. I believe it's typically 5 days in the contract, but you want to make sure you apply for your loan within the terms and conditions of the contract. And as we always talk about in our contract video and on many other videos, make sure you understand that the new contract dated April 2017, I guess that's not so new anymore, but you need to make sure you follow your loan approval deadline, which is typically 30 days in the contract. So the buyer, you need to make sure you apply for your loan and get your loan approved within the first 30 days. And if you find you're approaching that deadline and you have not been approved by your lender, you better either ask the seller for an extension or cancel the contract and get your money back. Very, very important. You do not want to jeopardize losing your hard-earned money and the only deposit you might have in order to buy the American dream of homeownership. Now we're going to talk about that home inspection. After you have an executed contract, you put up your first deposit, your real estate agent will help guide you in selecting a home inspector to come out and do your inspection. Make sure you hire someone that is very knowledgeable. Make sure you hire someone that is going to check all of the details of the house to make sure they do not miss anything. They want to check the electrical. They want to check the appliances. They want to check all of the air conditioning units and the heating units. And if there's pool equipment, they want to check the roof. They want to check for termites. There are so many things included in a home inspection. We're going to actually get a home inspector on one of our next episodes so we can kind of talk about all of the proper things that they are going to be checking. And don't forget, which we'll talk about when we get around the board here, at your final walkthrough, you want to kind of do almost a mini inspection. I know some buyers like to call a home inspector back in just to make sure the house is still in the condition it was at the time of your initial inspection, because that's what the contract calls for. The home must be delivered to the buyer in the same condition as when you saw it originally. Got it? Great. So now we're going to move on to the next one. We're talking about my favorite one, the title commitment and the title search report. Now, hopefully you're using Independence Title and we'll reach out to you and go over it. But if for any reason you are not using us, maybe you didn't get the chance to select the best title company to handle your closing, you want to make sure you call the title company and ask to review a copy of the title commitment or the title search report. That is going to tell you everything from who the buyer is, who the owner of record, the seller is, the legal description of the property. It's going to give all of the requirements, and most importantly, which we've talked about on previous episodes, it's going to give you the exceptions, everything that that title company is not going to cover you for in case it comes up. So those are typically, as you see in, let's say, an auto policy, the exclusions from coverage. So you want to look at the exclusions, ask them questions. Why is this on here? Maybe it can be removed. You want to be very careful, because that's where some title companies, the ones that don't do business the right way, hide things that they do not want to cover. They do not want to give you the coverage you're paying for on, so they put it as an exclusion. And if you don't ask the question or you do not review it, you could get stuck with a policy without coverage for certain items. Lien search is an important one. We talk about the difference between a title search, which we talked about just in that previous step, versus a lien search. Now, lien search does not uncover liens. That's what a title search is for. A lien search is talking about unrecorded municipal issues. So it could be a utility bill from a tenant or previous owner. It could be the current owner's utility bill. It could be permits, open, closed, and expired. Are very important to make sure the title company is ordering open, closed, and expired permits. Now, you remember, within your inspection period in the contract is when you need to check for permits. So either you need to make sure the title company orders a permit search, you need to make sure you order a permit search, or you need to make sure you exclude the permit search from your inspection period and make sure it will be brought in maybe at a later date, and then the seller will agree to comply. But you do need to address permitting issues. And then the last part of that municipal lien search, we're talking about code enforcement violations, not necessarily code enforcement liens, but it could be code enforcement notices, notice of violations, code enforcement issues. They could be accruing a daily fine. You want to make sure that that title company is ordering a municipal lien search. Why are we so adamant with telling you about that? Because there's title companies that do not order it, and they have you sign an agreement that says they have not ordered it, and you hold them harmless. So make sure you're asking the proper questions. Hey, title company, did you order a title search? Did you order a lien search? And make sure the lien search includes, that's right, permitting, open, closed, and expired permits. Now, this is one of my favorite boxes. Don't go to jail. Visit our website, titlerate.com, and right on the homepage, you're gonna see our video where we uncovered a home stealing scam here in South Florida. We worked in connection with the FBI, the state attorney, Fort Lauderdale Police, Broward Sheriff's Office, and we uncovered a home stealing scam here in South Florida. So very important, you don't wanna go to jail. You wanna know how to spot fraud in your next real estate transaction. So go to TitleRate.com and check out that video. That could hopefully prevent you from getting involved in a fraudulent real estate transaction. Now we're going to talk about homeowners insurance. I used to own an insurance company many years ago. It's a very important aspect of your home buying process. You want to make sure you're working with an agent that has the ability to quote out multiple agencies. You want to make sure they can go to multiple underwriters where they can get a quote from multiple different carriers in order to give you the best possible coverage. A lot of times you'll go get three or four quotes and they're totally different with different companies, and you want to ask your question why. Sometimes they have a lower deductible versus a higher deductible. Sometimes they do not have personal property coverage. Sometimes they have what's called actual cash value versus replacement costs. So you want to make sure you compare the quotes. Don't always go with the cheapest, because sometimes the cheapest, they leave something out. So you want to make sure your home is covered the proper value. You want to make sure you have personal property. You want to make sure you have replacement costs on your personal property. And you want to make sure that you have liability coverage. One of the tricks that a lot of insurance agents do in order to get your premium lower is maybe they give you a basic kitchen when you really have a premium kitchen. So that's going to bring up your coverage a little bit. But if you go with a basic and you have granite countertops and stainless steel appliances and this fancy kitchen, and you were to have some damage, they could potentially deny your claim. So it's not worth it to save a few dollars now to not have the proper coverage you need. So make sure you work with your homeowner's insurance company, and make sure when you get your inspection, when we back up a few to the home inspection, make sure you ask the home inspector while they're there to do a wind mitigation inspection and a four-point inspection if your home's a little bit older, because the insurance companies will need that to give you the maximum discounts. That's where they're talking about the coverages for hurricane. So every opening needs to be covered with either hurricane shutters, accordion shutters, impact glass. They want to check the straps on the roofing, the nailing on the roofing, in order to give you the maximum amount of discounts on your insurance policy. So make sure you ask that home inspector to do a wind mitigation inspection. And if the home is an older home, I believe over 40 years old, you want to make sure you get a four-point inspection, which is going to check like electrical and plumbing and foundation and things like that to make sure your home is up to proper code. Got it? Good. Now we're going to move to my favorite part, scheduling the closing. We need to come to the closing. This is the most important part, to make sure you schedule the closing out. Try not, as we talked about in other videos, schedule the closing for the 15th or the last day of the month. Try and do it a little bit sooner, especially if you're a tenant and you need a little bit of time to move out of your apartment, get into your house. Understand that the lenders, the insurance companies, the title companies, everyone's pulling their hair out the last day of the month. Like today, we're filming this towards the end of the month. The last day of the month, we'll typically have 15 to 20 closings in one day. So that's a lot of closings for one day, so why stress yourself out? If you're an agent, if you're a buyer, try and schedule your closing to accommodate your needs. Maybe do it on the Thursday before the Friday. Maybe do it a few days before the end of the month to give you an extra couple of days. Obviously, if you need to do it at the end of the month, it's okay. We always accommodate, but you want to make sure you do what's in your best interest and make sure you schedule that closing with the title company. Call them and ask, what time do you have available to come in and close? Make sure you get it scheduled ahead of time so you get the time that's most convenient for you. You want the time that's convenient for you, not the time that's convenient for them. So it's very important to schedule that closing ahead of time. Review your final closing statement. So your title company should by now have forwarded you a preliminary closing statement and your final closing statement. You want to go through it. Do not wait until you get to the closing table to go through your closing statement. You want to go through it a little bit ahead of time just to make sure you see everything on there. If you have any questions, call. Maybe you got double charged for something. Maybe there was something that was supposed to be on there that wasn't on there. Maybe your homeowner's insurance, you prepaid, but they're collecting it on the closing statement. So you want to make sure you check your closing statement, review it line by line. It's basically like an Excel spreadsheet, and make sure you understand everything on there. So this way, when you get to the closing table, you do not have a 3-hour closing. You can come in, make sure the numbers match, sign, and go enjoy your new home. Does that make sense? I hope it does. And I hope you learned something new to go schedule that closing a little bit ahead of time, review your documents ahead of time, and make sure when you come to closing, it's a great experience instead of becoming a stressful time because maybe there's something you didn't know. Now we're gonna move to wiring the final funds to close. We get asked all the time, well, can I bring a certified check? No, you cannot bring a certified check to closing. Certified checks are no longer valid for closing. The new contract says specifically in there, we need to have good funds, and good funds are defined by being in the bank and cleared. So if you come to me today for closing with a certified check and I put the money in the bank, it doesn't clear until midnight tonight at the earliest, where some title companies are now holding certified checks because of all the fraud that's going on. So you do want to make sure you wire transfer the money. That means you need to call your bank ahead of time. So if you're going through the buying process, call and make sure you're able to do wires at your bank. Find out the process, find out how much they charge, and make sure you wire your final funds to the title company. I say at least 24 hours before closing. So now you've reviewed your final closing statement, wire that money over to the title company. If there's an overage, you'll get that money back at the closing table. If you're short a little bit, you could then typically bring in a certified check for that little bit of difference, if it's a few hundred dollars, in order to get the closing done. So get that money to the title company, get it cleared in their escrow account so there are no delays. We never want to see a buyer not be able to take possession on a Friday because they couldn't get their wire to the title company in time. So it's so important to try and get it at least 24 hours ahead of closing, so you know the money is sitting there. So at the closing table, you sign everything, and now you're gonna get those keys to your house to be able to move in over the weekend and not have to wait till Monday because your wire was delayed. Final walkthrough is very important. You've wired your money. We're within 24 hours of closing, the day of closing, not the day before closing, not 2 days before closing. The morning before you get in your car and come over to the title company, go to the house and schedule your final walkthrough. Why? There are so many times we see damage to a house from the day before that when they went to the closing table, that damage wasn't there the night when they did it, the walkthrough the night before. Maybe there were squatters. We've had a story where all of a sudden they did the walkthrough the day before, they came to the closing table the next day, and then they went to move into the house and there was squatters in the house. Sovereign citizens broke into the house and tried to claim rights to the house. We had to call the police department, get the police to go there and kick these people out. You do not want that to happen. So make sure you try and limit the amount of time from your final walkthrough to your actual closing, so you can go and make sure all of the appliances work, the air conditioning unit works, the house is in good shape, the pool's not green. You wanna kinda almost do a mini inspection. You could always email our office. I think we have a walkthrough inspection that one of our inspectors did that we can always send to you, and you know, maybe that can be a good tool for you to use when you do your next walkthrough. But always make sure you limit the time from the walkthrough to the closing, the least amount of time possible, to make sure there's the least amount of damage or issues. So when you close and you get the keys to your house and you go to the house that at that next day, you wanna make sure that the house is in great condition. Now, celebration is the best part. This is where the balloons and the cake come out. You've closed on your house, you go to your house and you lay down on your kitchen floor. Your house is totally empty, so your voice is echoing like crazy. And you celebrate home ownership. Sometimes this is the largest investment that any one person is going to make. That's why people say it's the American dream of home ownership. You wanna make sure you celebrate that moment because you've worked so hard to get there. You've worked all of this time, you've saved all of this money, you've built up your credit and your income and your down payment money, and now you get a chance to celebrate the home that you will now raise your family in. So congratulations on getting to that point. And the last one I like to talk about, which is kind of a little plug for myself, is make sure that if you had a great experience at our company closing, or you're working with one of our competitors and you had a great experience with them, you let them know. Maybe go to Google, go to Facebook, and leave a very nice review for the company that did that closing. You know, any company works so hard to earn your business. I know we work very hard to earn our clients' business. We love to get reviews on Facebook, Yelp, and Google. And I'm sure the other competitors that we have would love to have the same. Now, always remember, if you had a bad experience, you want to let them know that as well, because as the owner here, you know, I want to know if one of my staff did something or there was something frustrating in that closing process, I would like to know so I can have the opportunity to correct it for the next buyer so they do not feel the same. So you may not want to go leave a negative review for someone. I always say go to the company first, voice your opinion, and see what they can do in order to turn that negative into a positive. So I hope you learned something new. We're back at the go button, which means you can rinse and repeat and do it all over again for your next house, or share this video with someone else you know that's thinking about buying or selling a house. I hope this Titleopoly was a wonderful asset for you. I hope it's a wonderful tool in order to walk you through some of the basics of the closing process so you make sure you can start and end at the same point and get your home. So if you enjoyed this video, please share it on social media. Click the red subscribe button there for next week's episode. Share it on Facebook, on Twitter, on LinkedIn. Let somebody know about this video, because I think this is a great video that can help somebody successfully close on their home. So as always, my name's Kevin Thatcher, the founder and CEO here at Independence Title, signing off. And I look forward to seeing you at the closing table.